Good morning, how are you? And and I hope you had a wonderful evening yesterday. And leaving this place and have a good dinner and relax at the evening. So now we are going to have a lecture by Dr. Satish on Aerosolan climate. He gave you two lectures, now and one day more. As you know, Professor Satish is one of the leading authority not only in India but in work on aerosol studies. He has done his master's from the University of Kerala and subsequently he worked as a junior research fellow at BSSC, the Kerala Space Center, which is a part of ISRO, and then a PhD also from the University of Kerala. And after completing his PhD from there, he joined the postdoc in the Institute of Oceanography and worked with one of the leading authorities in the world at that time, and then he joined his community science. You see his wide time, he has received all awards one possibly get in the field of science. And he's a fellow of all Indian academies, fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences, fellow of Allahabad Academy. So he is one of the top authorities in the field. He has also a lead author last 2 years or three times in IPCC, two times in IPCC on aerosol studies. And if you see his publication, they are all journals, but you can APR, top journals of science and medical education. And today he is considered as one of the leaders in his field, and particularly in aerosol study. And he has taken numerous initiatives to further this work, and now he is leading future learning program from entire we are extremely fortunate to have him, and very recently he has taken over as a chairman of the Czech. And we are extremely fortunate to have him here and deliver these talks. It's very difficult to get him, he is very busy man and he requires pretty well, he travels quite often, but he's kind enough to give this talk. And I hope you will enormous benefit because aerosol and glaciers. It's not a hot topic as of now, because people talk that snow and will significantly changes because of the deposition of the carbon in the aerosol. So you will get some idea, basic idea about climate and aerosols, and subsequently we will talk about any kind of outcome of the snow and glacier.
Thank you, sir, for the kind words. Good morning to all. We are talking about aerosol and climate, with a special emphasis on glacier studies.
As Professor Kulkarni said, I have two lectures, and I am assuming that you don't have in-depth knowledge about aerosols. So before I talk about aerosol impact on glaciers, this will be during the second lecture. And I needed to tell you what are aerosols and the radiative effects and all. You are probably interested in aerosol because of two reasons. One is the deposition of black carbon on snow, so that its reflectance can be reduced. And second is, if aerosol can reach glacier altitudes, then it can have a warming effect, and in addition to CO2, global warming, you may have a black carbon induced warming on glacier. So these are probably the reasons you may be interested in aerosols. So I will give special emphasis to this. So I will talk about basic student, assuming that you don't have much background on aerosols, and I will talk about some of the climate impacts. And second one, I will show you some of the aerosol observations relevant to Himalayan glaciers.
we have done, and that will be completely about the impact of Black Carbon Monoxide. I'm sure you know what is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and this is the 2013 report. And you can see that global upwelling surface temperature is ever increasing. And it is now clear that increase in CO2 concentration is one of the major causes of such temperature increase. But in addition to that, there are more species, I will tell you more about that, that is aerosol species also contributing to this increase in temperature. How many of you have read about the COP21 meeting in Paris conducted during last year? Because if you read newspaper, you will see a lot of news about aerosols and COP. This is United Nations Climate Change Conference. The purpose of this conference was to discuss and debate how we can contain the global average temperature within 2 degrees. Compared to pre-industrial levels. Currently, it is about a degree above pre-industrial level, and it is going to go up for sure, because you know carbon dioxide lifetime is more than 100 years, not 100 years. So whatever is emitted is there in the atmosphere, so it is going to go. There's no way we can stop it. Few decades will continue. So if we reduce the carbon dioxide concentration now, its impact will be there a little more, right? Maybe 2030, 40. But it is not possible to stop completely also. So the main purpose of this conference was to for the nations to announce something called intended nationally determined contributions, INDC. That is, every country was supposed to announce how much they will reduce their emissions and by then. Do you know how much India has announced? You said you have read this news. So can you tell us what was India's commitment to this conference? Because every country announced some reduction.
5%.
5%. 5% is too small. 33% they agreed to reduce their CO2 emission intensity by 2030. 20 is very difficult, now only 3 more years. 2030. And in addition to that, the country also committed to change some of the coal-based power sector to renewable energy, that is wind energy and solar energy. That is also, but there is no legal binding, that is also there. Because past experience, if you are following Kyoto Protocol, any other protocol, you know that nobody is going to follow whatever is committed. Because they will continue business as usual, and the carbon dioxide will be emitted. So there are some international politics involved. I will tell you, I will show you a few slides about that, because I cannot talk aerosol without telling international politics involved. Because that you should know. And as I said, there are two radially reactive species you need to know when we talk about global warming or any climate impact. Only CO2 and aerosol. Aerosol, you have many types of aerosol, but for you, black carbon aerosols are the most important type. And again, I don't have to introduce black carbon aerosol or other thing if you are reading the Hindu or any other national daily. So you have probably seen all these reports. See, from 2002 onwards, There have been several news published in newspapers that black carbon contributed to droughts and floods in India and China, and soot blocks sunlight and result in reduced profit like that. And then finally, one of the recent ones is potential impacts of Asian carbon aerosol on future US farming, that's United States. So you read it from here to here. If you have an ability, usually researchers have this ability to read in between lines. It's not simply what is written here. You needed to know, if you want to be a researcher, you should have a capability to read in between lines. It's a saying like that. So, what you understand from 2002 to 2012, there is something hidden actually in this. It starts with science, rocks and blood, and slowly it is growing and turning to politics, international politics. So initially, black carbon was originally discovered. It was not discovered actually, it was known. But black carbon's climate impact was recognized during late 90s. Until then it was not known. And thereafter, it started with science. And then slowly it has become a topic for politics, international politics. And it has some impact on international policy. That's why I told you that COP21 meeting. So I will tell you about that. And for you, black carbon aerosol and glaciers, there is no shortage of news items in that regard also. You can see that black carbon has a significant factor in the human and glaciers. Science news, but it is only later part. Then it started, and then NASA news, all this news, 90% of the human education will be so. This you keep it in mind, I will come back to that little later. And then there are studies, one of the first. He said that in 1962, glacier, some one of the glaciers, 2077 square kilometer has produced. So there is a 23% reduction in the glacier area from this Yama Sorosa Indicus. He said remote sensing is the most efficient technique for studying glacier and glacier area. And at the same time, you can see that there is a five-fold increase in the aerosol concentration over India. If you want to correlate the two, you will get a good correlation. What this versus this, what we have two more points in between. Even in now, but now we have points in between. So if you put this two and then make a scatter plot, you will get 90% or 95% correlation. But the question is, whether you have 90% correlation, does it mean that aerosols are causing glacier, or is it some other reason? That is a topic for debate again. So we cannot say that, because if it is only correlation, I can tell you another example. You have this aerosol concentration measurement all over India. You take anywhere, you have maximum aerosol concentration during summer season and then minimum during monsoon season because of various different reasons. And if you take any of the vegetable prices in the market, that also maximum during summer, it is because availability is less, and during monsoon season and winter season you have low price. So you plot aerosol concentration versus vegetable price, you will get a good correlation. Does it mean that aerosol concentration is determining vegetable price, or vegetable price is determining aerosol concentration? No, that is not good. So this is what I want to tell about this plot. Yeah, correlations are there. People are using lot of correlations, correlation analysis to say that there is impact correlation. It's much, much more than that. You probably have heard, or you will hear from Professor Kulkarni about mass balance, several things. It is not just like you take an ice cube in a pan and heat it, you will measure. It is not like that. Glacier is a very complex topic. So that you will hear. So I will tell you all what are aerosols in this black matter. Aerosols are particles of sodium or liquid phase of and the typical size is 0.5 micrometer and making it radiative, very active. Thus, you have probably, if you are a physics student, you have probably studied that when your particle or scatterer size is comparable to that of wavelength of radiation. That is the reason it is very active in the visible region, and most of your sunlight is also coming in the visible picture. So you can see a lot of effects of aerosol, you cannot see directly. They are so small. And there are several reasons why aerosols are important. Definitely it is due to radiative effects, and then there is another reason, health effect. Aerosol can go to lungs and ask problems in lungs, irritation and even lung cancer. And similarly, in deposit on skin and cause skin cancer also. There are evidences by pigmented lung cancer in this country and abroad. But we are not expert in that. But our interest is this radiative effect, because of radiative effects, climatic one. And remote sensing people are also interested because it is a layer between satellite and the surface of the air. So you need to study the surface of the air, you need to know about it. And agriculture also it is important because it can deposit on the surface of the leaf and can reduce the cropping. And also it can reduce the surface leaching from radiation and energy light available for photosynthesis also. Not in tropical region but mid latitude. Tropical region we have enough sunlight, there is no problem. Even if there also reduce sunlight a little bit, there is no problem. But you go to Punjab, it's going to be a problem because you don't have angle, the sun's angle is very high. So you don't have enough radiation. So it can affect a small change in aerosol. Effective cropping. And it can be natural sources like soil dust, sea salt, volcanic volcanoes. And also it can be man-made or technically called anthropogenic. So you have industrial surface from industries, biocarbon from biomass burning and fuel emission, and organic aerosol from agriculture burning or trees. And whether the aerosol system leads to a cooling or warming depends on the relative dominance of all. If you have a lot of black carbon aerosol, if they cause warming effect, and if you have a lot of sulfate, which is scattering type, you will have a cooling effect. And this is a typical source strength. If you take all over the globe, natural aerosol abundance is several factors larger than anthropogenic aerosol. And you may note that there is no direct relation between aerosol mass or liquid properties and radiative properties. You can see that black carbon is contributing to the biomass burning, contributing only 3% to the mass, this is mass, total mass of the aerosol. But radiative, this contribution to the total is 65%. So there is no, it is not directly proportional because of refractive index. I will show you a few slides after. And these are some of the radiative effects. That this is sea salt aerosol, which is scattering type, and dust aerosol is partly absorbing. For you, it is dust aerosol and black carbon aerosol which are interesting for the deposition of both of these on glacier surface which have impact. And dust aerosol can affect 12% of the illuminated dust particles with the light, 88% is scattered and 12% is absorbed. But at the same time, if you see black carbon aerosol, 77% is absorbed and 23% is scattered. And this cooling or warming depends on how they are mixed. And you need to know number density, size distribution, and refractive. These are the three important parameters you need to know if you want to calculate or estimate the radiative impact of aerosols. So this is a typical distribution. Aerosol size distribution is usually represented with the log. This is two sources, two different forms. Similarly, super question of all this size distribution, you will get something like this primordial or primordial. And this is what we get from directly from an instrument, how the aerosol size structure looks like. And your job is to convert size distribution to optical properties and then relieve. Then only you can calculate this impact on glaciers. And in very briefly, you can say what is the impact of aerosol on climate. In general, you can say aerosol can directly impact climate by scattering incoming sunlight back to space and also by absorbing sunlight. And there is something called indirect effect. Indirect effect, aerosol can act as cloud conductor and it can affect the cloud microbes. So it can modify the properties and lifetime of clouds. Why lifetime? Because if you have a large number of aerosols, your water vapor availability is limited. So you will have a large number of small particles and then it will not rain. But if you have a smaller number of particles, you have a small number of large particles and they are heavy, the pollution coalescence will be more efficient and it will can write. So when you have a large number of errors of something like Indian region, then what is happening is you have several non-precipitating cloud cycles, up to 4 to 9 times cloud condenses and evaporate before it can rain. So that is called the direct. And direct effect is mainly scattering and absorption. I just want to remind you, Valley and Hill scattering, you don't remember. And this is the reason for Valley scattering is responsible for the blue color of the sky. And red color very important is scattering of nuclear ozone. And in the equation, only thing we need to know is inversely proportional to lambda ratio. So that is a characteristic feature of Valley scattering. This is how the angular distribution looks like. You have particle size much, much smaller than lambda. You have Rayleigh scattering, equally scattered in the forward and backward direction. And this is compared to the size of E scattering, and this is more complex pattern of E scattering when you have particle size larger than wavelength of radiation. And this is the efficiency factor. You don't need to know much about it, but what is in the box, red box is Rayleigh scattering. And then after that, in asymptotic, we go to 2, which is scattering efficiency factor. So then you have particle size, alpha is 2 pi r by lambda. R is particle size and lambda is wavelength of radiation. And when you have r equal to lambda, your alpha here, what is plotted here is 2 pi, that is 6.28. You can see that scattering is maximum. So just this is the message I want to say. When scattering is maximum, when your particle size is comparable to wavelength, that is the fundamental. And you have probably heard about aerosol radiative forcing, and this is a very common thing. Any radiative impact of aerosol is expressed in terms of forcing, expressed in watts per meter square, and it is defined as the change in radiation for the shortwave or long wave in the presence of aerosol. You can estimate. I had a few slides on the estimation of that, then I realized that I am not going to finish it in 1 hour or 45 minutes. So I have deleted it. You can, if you have time, you can, I can show you later, but not today. So radiative forcing is very much important if you want to study any of the radiative. I will introduce you to 3 important parameters you may need to process. One is aerosol optic effect. This is defined as the integrated extinction coefficient. I don't know if you remember what is extinction coefficient. If you remember Lambert theorem, you know that if you are illuminating any medium of thickness dx or ds with the initial intensity of I0, then what you get on the other side is I0 exponential minus k into length of the sea. This is called the Lambert theorem. So this is the most fundamental law. If you are a physics student, you will have to know the plate, but otherwise, you can just see this. It is simply telling you how much energy is absorbed in the medium and how much is scattered in the medium. And if you are illuminating from one side, how much you will get. This is important for atmosphere. It is assume that this is an atmospheric layer. Small degrees. This is how climate models and radiation models are coming. You needed to divide the atmosphere into small, small layers and then calculate all this. So, this is that K is extinction coefficient. This K is extinction coefficient actually. That is a characteristic of the medium. Similarly, atmosphere also, different layers if you divide, this is vertical extent of the atmosphere. And if you divide it as a function of height, dH, dH plus dH, like that you can divide. Layers of thickness dH. Then if you integrate this from surface to the top of the atmosphere, what you get is optical. For you, both optical and the vertical distribution of extinction coefficient, both are important. Because for you, if your glacier altitude is 7 km or 6 km, you need to know what is extinction coefficient at that level to calculate the warming rate at that altitude. And then another parameter is single scattering albedo and scattering phase function. Single scattering albedo is, it describes the contribution of scattering to extinction. If you have 100% extinction, how much is due to scattering and how much is due to absorption? Because your extinction, that is from the Lambert Vierla, I have shown you, you have some energy lost in the medium. When you are illuminating from one side, your energy is lost, part of the energy is lost. It is 100% you are with 100 units you are illuminating, the other side you might get 60 or 65 or 70. So that means 30-35 units are lost in the medium. So that loss is due to scattering and absorption. So that is called extinction. So extinction is sum of scattering and absorption. And this SSA, that is single scattering and described, how far fraction is due to scattering? That is one, single scattering algebra of one. That means you have a complete scattering atmosphere. If your single scattering algebra is zero, then it means you have completely absorbing atmosphere. In between the two, and why this is important? Because the ratio of scattering to extinction or ratio of absorption to extinction determine the warming point. If it is a completely scattering medium, it cannot heat. It cannot warm the atmosphere. If it is a completely absorbing medium, then it can intensely heat the atmosphere. So you need to know at your altitude of your interest, whether the aerosols are warming type or cooling type. That is why this parameter is important. And phase function, I have already shown you that polar diagram. So knee scattering, again, I deleted that slide because it is so complicated for you at this stage. So it's involved the spherical Bessel function and the law. So unless you are expert in mathematics, it's difficult to describe that. So now I will go to this direct radial portion in a very simple way. Below 4 micrometer, that is short wave radiation. I am not going to long wave radiation. Long wave radiation also will have some effects on the glaciers, but mostly long wave leads to cooling effect, and short wave absorption is responsible for the warming of the atmosphere. So below 4 micrometer, that is short wave radiation, if you have aerosol and you have a scattering and absorption, then that can lead to a reduction of solar radiation at the surface. There is an increase in the reflected absorption. If you consider it as a single lens, the whole atmosphere, if you consider it as a single lens, you have this effect. And this indicates that some energy is lost in the atmosphere, but this is already smaller than this. The first reduction is much, much larger, 2 to 3 times larger than how much is the increase in the reflected absorption. That means this is lost in the space. This is reduced at the surface. So the rest is available in the atmosphere. That means it is absorbed. And then what will happen? Absorbed energy? Any amount of energy absorbed in the atmosphere will be utilized to heat the atmosphere, and that will be emitted as long wave radiation. Long wave means above 4 micrometers. The reason is Wien's displacement law. If you still remember radiation law, you know that atmosphere cannot be 6000 Kelvin, so it cannot emit short wave radiation. It can be 28 or 30 degrees. So any increase in the atmosphere will be emitted only in the form of long wave radiation. So this is just to show you how we found the aerosols are important. This is due to one-time interruption. Nobody knew the importance of aerosols, but during 1982, this El Chichol volcanic eruption and another one, if you have to go in Philippines, we have observed that there can be a large reduction of solar radiation following the volcanic eruption. And it's demonstrated that they also can cool the planet. But remember, volcanic eruption mostly inject sulfate or so, which is scattering type. So scattering type will not lead to absorption, it is mostly scattering type. And I will show you this Pinatubo flow. This is somewhere it started and it is going to the stratosphere. So once the aerosols are in the stratosphere, you get mixed with intense circulation pattern. It's not like lower atmosphere. Stratospheric altitudes are very high circulation, very strong circulation system is there. So see, from a single point, you see how it filled the whole flow. So anything injected at that level will get mixed over the globe very fast. So there is some importance I will tell you little later. And if you, so far I have talked about the regional effects. Now if you want to see, it's not just for your general awareness. If you want to study on a global basis, consider the Earth atmospheric system as one system. then this is the equation you can use. This is solar constant, and this is 0 by 4 minus alpha. Alpha is the reflectance of the planet, that's the atmospheric system. And sigma T raised to 4, T is the effective radiating temperature of the atmospheric system. And this is emitted. So any energy emitted will give it to a cooling effect. And this is what is absorbed in the atmosphere. This 1 minus alpha is 1 minus reflectance. So reflectance is removed, so whatever is trapped in the atmosphere is shown here. If you are interested, you can remember this equation. It can be a question for interviews and for admission. And aerosol can have a significant influence in determining the value of alpha. And hence, it has one significant impact on alpha. This is the most simple way anybody can tell what is the impact of aerosol on climate in general. So this is how, if you know how much change in the reflectance, you can calculate how much, once you know the parameters relevant to aerosol, you can calculate how much change in the reflectance aerosol can make. And then all these things are known. So you can see how much the change in the effective radiation compared to the atmospheric system. And I told you about the indirect radiative effect that aerosol can act as a global condensation. This is a simple representation of how aerosol act as a radiation and for more detailed analysis indicates that this is an old time proof. I told you that volcanic aerosols are mostly sulfate aerosol and also it is scattering light. But in addition to that, volcanic sulfate is also hygroscopic. Hygroscopic means it means it has affinity to water. It can act as cloud condensation nuclei and it can form clouds. So you can see that the volcanic plume is shown by this dotted line. And wherever the volcanic plume is traveling, you can see the cloud formation. That is the old principle. This is true. Known from 1950s. Because the very first studies on aerosols, they have concentrated on aerosol impact of clouds, that is 55 aerosol studies. So this is not nothing new, but what is not known and known now is the cloud suppression due to aerosol. So until 1890s, it was the belief that aerosol can increase the cloud cover. But you can see here, this is a cloud covered area near a biomass burning, forest fire, Brazil, Amazon forest. You can see that a lot of smoke is there. And wherever smoke is there, you don't have clouds. So the hypothesis is that black carbon aerosols from this biomass ready for forest fires, it can cause intense warming of the atmosphere and can evaporate clouds. Clouds cannot sustain in an environment where black carbon is there. So unfortunately, our region also we have a large amount of black carbon aerosols. These effects are not known. It's undergoing, studies are undergoing. And there are so many recent questions I can make. On whole day I can talk to you like this. But due to shortage of time, I will show you some of these questions and then go to the other topics in this lecture. What are the impacts of our anthropogenic aerosol on this? It's not known. It's still undergoing. Is aerosol protein similar in magnitude to that of greenhouse gas? Greenhouse gases can cause warming effect and some of the aerosol can cause cooling effect, whether they can offset the or at least partially offset the greenhouse gas portion or not. What is the impact of aerosol on cloudiness? And then can aerosol alter the geological cycle? Can aerosol impact glacial melting and many more? I can list again several slides here. And this is our lab in COS. We have several instruments here. If you have time, and this instrument. This instrument is not here, it is moved into another location. But all kinds of instruments, including microprocessor, is available in our class. And in addition to commercially available instruments, we also make instruments. These are some of the instruments we have designed. Interferometer for refractive index of aerosol and polarization characteristics of aerosol scattering. And this is an angular scattering instrument. The face, how the aerosols are scattering at different angles.
very important. And in addition to laboratory instrument, we use ISRO's research aircraft. Almost every year we use ISRO's research aircraft. Just now we completed our campaign this year over Indo-Pacific region. That is starting from Rajasthan to Calcutta, over Lucknow and Delhi. We just completed an impact. And we also use this Sagar Kenya. There are later ships now, recently board ship. But we extensively use the Sagar Kenya, that is a research ship of Ministry of Science. And we also use this EAFR high altitude. Because aircraft, why we are doing is for glacier studies, for example, you need it more altitude distribution of aerosols. Most of the aerosols are near the surface. So we need to know what altitude aerosol can reach. So Indo-Gangetic Basin is important because it is very close to Himalayan glaciers. So that is why we are working on that region. And also this high altitude balloon facility this also can provide us a vertical extent of aerosol. This is one of our experiments.
इधर मुड़ रहा
है
आया थी यार वो फट गया इधर ही ब्याह का दो यूँ करते
हैं वन टर्न
ऑफ पेरो अब सुपर है फुट लॉन्च
है We also can telecom and ask the instrument
to blast. I have to go to the
instrument. I
have to go to the instrument. I have to go to the instrument.
Yes, for that. Why is it moving in that direction? We will be asking to come bringing back for blast in the way. And in addition to that, we develop satellite sensors in our lab. This is one of the examples, AeroSat, it's a smart satellite for light absorbing aerosol. So far, there is no satellite which can try black carbon aerosol. For glacier studies, it is very important that black carbon aerosol concentration should be known. So far, there is no satellite in black carbon. So we will be launching this in 2017 or 2018. It is designed here, and ISRO will launch it. And the main principle is polarization. You can see that it's a polarizer. You cannot see below because of strong reflection from the surface. For example, if you want to study glaciers, it's all snow. You have 90% of reflection. You cannot see anything below. So once you have a polarizer, then you can see below. So below the water, you can see this frog. Otherwise, you cannot see that. So we use the multi-angle and polarization technique to study aerosol over different terrain. So far, any reflecting terrain, you cannot study aerosol because of this reflection. So very briefly, I will tell you about why Indian climate science community is concerned about this aerosol. And also a few outstanding issues about that. Again, I will not have time to discuss all because it will be a long lecture. But briefly, I will tell you some of the issues. So one thing, first one. This is 1984 to 2012. The aerosol concentration is increasing at 2.4% at per year. This is aerosol of the air. It's a measure of aerosol concentration. And if this is continuing, you can see that if you extrapolate it to 1948, your aerosol optic energy will be 1, and aerosol optic energy is 1 according to Lambert Weyl law, which I have shown you. It means exponential decrease in the surface reaching solar radiation. That means now you are getting 90% of radiation, that will come to 37% of radiation. That is out of 100. Solar constant will get only exponential of that. And that is what will happen in 2048 if it continues to rise. And
then we constitute glaciers also. So this is all over India, but if you take hydrogenetic basis, this will be much faster. And this can reach 2030 or 32. It can reach what? And this is black carbon photosynthesis from ISRO's ARFINET network of observatories. We have about 30 sites. Can be the black carbon. And highest black carbon mass concentration is also lower than you can see that very fine bovril microgram per meter cube air compared to Bangalore or any other. So, and its proximity to glaciers, that is an alarming fact. And this is from pollution control board. This is about health hazard, not but it has obligation to glacier also. Any satellite image if you take for May, June, July, you will see this band of thick aerosols. And you can also see that according to the latest pollution control board report, the five cities with the largest amount of particulate matter is Kanpur, Kolkata, Delhi, Patna, and all are. And there is a reason why it is so polluted, because Mumbai and Chennai are much more polluted than Indo-Pacific. Then why it is not showing? Why this is only shown? The reason is topography. One good reason is topography. You have Himalayas here and you have islands here. So this is like a canal. When you have a temperature inversion, that is at 1 kilometer or 0.5 kilometer. So it is like a gas chamber. The entire region is like a gas chamber. And also 16 out of 23 major 100 plus water water. So that is and pollution dispersion also is determined by sources, things and meteorology. As I said, over Mumbai and all land sea breeze circulation will clean the pollution whatever is emitted there. But here you don't have such an option because of the Himalayas and highlands. And these are the three factors which can remove aerosol pollution, rain, clouds and gravity. And there is a saying that solution to pollution is dilution, but that is not happening in the Indo-Pacific. These two examples that we have high in the Indo-Pacific, but over Indo-Pacific basis, it is mostly blocked by Himalayas. So that is why the high development. But the question is how much of that near the surface can reach the top level? That the answer is dispersion model. Simple dispersion model I will show you in the next lecture. You can calculate whether the aerosols injected at the near the surface into various activities can reach glacier level or not. And topography, meteorology, all those things will matter. And as I said yesterday, Himalayas contain the largest amount of water outside polar ice caps and peak is the one great glacial members. And it has a lot of implications to water supply over there. ICAC report has now probably have exaggerated the fact, but still it's true. Observation shows that there is something to worry about. Another issue we are worried about is the representation of aerosols in climate modeling. And you can see that if you input same input to two different climate models, you get two different. That is what, because any aerosol climate impact studies, they use extensively climate models for chemistry transport model. You take any two model and give the same input, and you get two different outputs. The reason is parameterization and other great resolution. It's not surprising that you will get, but what is happening here is different climate models are given different inputs, and you get different outputs. So that is why we don't have a conclusive, we cannot say a conclusive statement about what is the impact of aerosol on climate. And contrasting inferences are quite obvious because they use different studies, use different models, different parameterization, different input data sets. Some of them use satellites, some of them assume aerosol parameters. Like this is just an example, aerosol impact on consumption. One set of people are saying that aerosol pass drought and others. It's a lot published literature. And aerosol delay one set of monsoon levels, advance. So there is no conclusive statement about here also. And then there are two well-known arguments about aerosol in background. That is aerosol absorption and subsequent warming can lead to advanced and subsequent intensification of gas bubbles. And another group of people are saying that solar beaming at the sunflower can slow down hydrological cycle and reduce functional impact. And you can see the model, how where the model stands. This is three well-known models in aerosol, and you can see that the difference between reality and the model output is as much as a factor of 6 to 8. So we cannot rely on that. And one last point I want to talk about is policy. As I said before, I complete, I needed to say a few words about policy, because without international policy, we cannot complete an aerosol lecture. This is some general information. And one major problem this community, the aerosol community, has been facing this international policy. For example, politically motivated interpretation of scientific data, which I showed you in the very first Indian aerosols are affecting the US and Africa. And there is a tendency to project the mitigation of EC as a good solution to the security problem. That is one reason I have shown you COP21 meeting, one slide about that at the beginning. The reason is, developed countries, they don't want to reduce CO2. So what they can tell is black carbon is responsible for the warming. So developing countries need to reduce black carbon. That is one argument in all these international meetings here. And also the tone of changes for support associated with scientific publication, including my impact channel like Nature or Science, indicates a political agenda relevant replace CO2. Climate change negotiation, wherever CO2 is there, they want to bring to the table black carbon also. So the question is whether black carbon can act in a similar way as being out there. The answer is no. The reason is black carbon, even though absorbed but not released, is extinction coefficient, is several orders of magnitude smaller in infrared. So CO2 is absorbing the infrared. It cannot act as a greenhouse. And greenhouse gas absorbed in earlier Indian day and night cannot cool the earth surface. But black carbon can cool the surface. It is popularly known as dimming. And simultaneously, that is possible to be. So, this is a major issue to be overlooking towards black carbon, whether it is IPCC or COP meetings. CO2 versus black carbon is a hot topic. And mitigation of aerosol, if you do a simple gradient transfer calculation, you can see that surface cooling is larger than atmospheric warming. You will not understand the details, but this is the point you need to say. If black carbon surface cooling is much larger than its warming. So, because of surface cooling, how much? Because atmosphere gets heated from the surface. Not getting heated directly from the sunlight. So, how much is the reduction of atmospheric cooling due to the surface cooling needed to be accounted before calculating anything? And also, there is an important thing: black carbon is never emitted slow, whether it is vehicular emission or biomass burning emission. It is also emitted along with organic carbon, which is highly scattered type. So, most of the calculation shows that. Warming effect due to PC is offset due to organic carbon. So the net effect is cooling due to sulfate. So there is no, we need to understand the relative importance of various aerosol species to warming and the cooling before undertaking the PC mitigation effect. That is very important. And continuing with the first slide about about the aerosol impact on climate. There is a recent report, you can see that pollution from Asia circles global atmospheric rise. So the point here is, I have shown you a video. Once you have, I showed you an organic eruption. But if you have some reason, aerosol can reach stratospheric altitudes. You have seen that it can go around the globe anywhere. It is not like lower troposphere. Stratospheric circulation is very strong and it can reach anywhere in the globe. And this is the point this paper is making, and it's a very recent paper. But again, aerosol affecting monsoon circulation or monsoon circulation affecting aerosol is not known. So this is a thing which is conveniently forgotten in all those studies. So we needed to worry about it. And then last example I want to show is this one. Asian brown cloud threatens rivers. That is one very important thing because if emissions of dark colored aerosol from India, China and Southeast Asia have continued to grow, temperatures of the United States will rise by 0.5 degrees by 2. So, this is a paper India published in 2005. And this, if you very carefully read these statements, you can see that it is not purely science. There are so many other things involved in this. So that is one problem which we as aerosol community we are facing. Whatever we study, we will have to think twice whether to publish or not. Because unfortunately we have a large amount of aerosol in this region. But whether we publish it, somebody can use it. That is also there. So we have to be very cautious in doing aerosol. And this is some of the news items immediately after that. Burning fuel particles do more damage to climate than what time and voice of the and most important thing is somewhere it is yeah, black carbon second only to CO2 in climate change. Voice of the I can tell you if when we said second only, that is true. Nobody can deny it. Just as I said, there are only two warming agents, CO2 and black carbon. Second means CO2 warming is very high and black carbon warming is very, very small. There is nothing in between. So it is similar to saying that in a class, the first class first is 99 marks and second was about 1 mark. Still means second. Everybody else got zero. So it is like that. So it is true. Black carbon is second only in CO2, but no way comparable. These are all very missing data. And the most important one is International Council for Scientific Opinion, black carbon and warming is worse than we thought. So this is another statement. And in summary, concluding here, I will talk about aerosol impact on glaciers specifically in the next lecture. And this is some of the observations we have made. Current assessment of black carbon dynamics is unrealistic as of now. Several climate-related aerosol parameters are still unknown or uncertain. And there are so many questions and crucial questions to be answered. Are so many compared to what is known in aerosol. Thank you. Glacier activity is 4 onwards, 4 or 5 or 6 kilometers above the surface. So one thing which we need to understand is what fraction of this aerosol can reach glacier altitudes. For that you need to have this dispersion models, chemistry transport models, and main problem is resolution. Most of these models are 50 kilometer resolution and meant for a north region. But you can see that in Himalayan region you have sudden changes in topography. So it is very difficult to run a model of a complex topography.
There is no question, and let us thank
you. So, what are the main reasons for driving driving forces for aerosols to such a height, sir?
What is convection, monsoon,
atmospheric circulation.
Circulation, if you have a strong vertical current, it can reach higher altitude. And there are several mechanisms which, that is actually the subject for second talk. The next talk, next lecture, I will. There are so many mechanisms. Surface aerosol can reach higher altitude. We have observation also, hypothesis also, models also. That is next lecture. But it is possible.
We will have a small break, 15 minutes.
Yeah.